Lovely.
Toast is coming.
Thank you very much. Yeah, some brown sauce would be great, thank you. So in order of table layout, if you're gonna eat your breakfast perfectly, it starts now. So thank you very much indeed. Got to have the table vaguely symmetrical. I can't have the eggs nearest me. It's to do with planning. It feels respectful to my breakfast. We've gone for the crucifix formation today. If I'm honest, I have no idea whether what I do would qualify as OCD. It's something that I always do when I eat a breakfast, but I'm pretty sure that's because I enjoy it and it makes me laugh when I do it. So, and I know there will be people for whom even coming out to a cafe is just an impossibility because of their OCDs. So how do those with the most extreme forms of OCD get treated? In a mental health hospital in South London is the country's only dedicated inpatient unit for those severely affected by the condition.
Hi, you must be John.
Yes,
come on in. Welcome to the OCD service.
Such is the stigma around the condition that I can't get to meet any of the patients face to face. But Dr. Lynn Drummond has offered to show me around.
By the time people come here, they're really at the very severe end of OCD. And to justify needing these beds, they need to be either a danger to themselves or others, which with OCD is usually to do with lack of self-care. About half of the people, when they first come here, are incontinent of urine and faeces. That could be either because they're fearful of contamination from the toilets, or it could be that they're so slowed up, trying to do everything so perfectly, that they actually don't move very quickly. So you get people moving almost like robots when they first come.
Treatment here combines anti-anxiety medication and the recognised standard practice of what's called exposure and response prevention therapy, where patients are gradually encouraged to face their fears.
For example, if somebody has contamination issues, John, by dirt and germs from toilets, the first thing we might do would be to encourage you to touch the toilet handle, and then I would ask you to spread the contamination and to remain like that for several hours at one time. If you were able to do that and it was caused very little anxiety, we might move on and touch the taps, and then when you got very confident, to touch the toilet seat, and again spreading the contamination.
My brain's saying we're going to shake hands when I go out and you've touched the toilet.
Well, I was actually rather hoping that you might be able to do that, John, as well.
This is just weird now, isn't it? I can touch it there.
If you could, you know, if you see, I went for two hands.
Should I wash my hands afterwards before I go?
I would
out?
Ask you to wait for at least 2 hours before you washed your hands.
Right. Ooh. Right, then.
That's it, well done. Good, good. And just move them around.
Oh, I could
great,
feel
rub
that.
Them together and touch yourself. Those clothes are going to be contaminated for the rest of the day. Just touch yourself.
Ooh.
Good, yeah.
I can do the trousers.
Great, well done. Well done, that's tremendous.
I can feel where I've touched myself.
Yeah, good, excellent. And the hair. Run your fingers through the hair. Oh, what about this? Good, good
on your head. Just shout on my head.
That's really good. Given the choice between the risk of what I just did and spending 20, 30, 40 years imprisoned by OCD, would this be worth the risk? I think the answer to me is it's a no-brainer.
Yeah. Let's move away from the toilet.
Well done. I think you did really well in there, John. It's the kind of thing we'd do in treatment. But obviously, I'd never start at that level normally. But as you practiced it, I think you'll find that over the next 1 to 2 hours, your anxiety will dissipate and will go down. you might be surprised at how quickly people can actually turn around once they've got the help, once they've got the support, and once they realise the job that needs to be done. Mm.
80% of people here respond well to this practical style of treatment.
The ways of coping and the ways of getting back to a normal life seem very strong. And I think this is the first time I've felt positive that you can move back down the scale and you can control things more and be happier. It leaves me with piss and poo on my hands. Poop hands. Oh, I'm not gonna die, am I? Tell me I'm not gonna die. You get Lynn to tell me I'm not gonna die.
So where do all my compulsions and obsessions come from? I've come to Lancaster, where I grew up, to meet the person who knows all my secrets.
Come to see my mum to find out.
Hello, hello mummy.
Hello, Johnny. Right. Let's go up and find out if I was a weird child.
Hello. How are you?
Look nice.
You realise we'll just edit this out if it displeases me.
Well, that's why I got them out, thinking
them. Oh,
see, you fatty, did have to cope fat. With some hideous wallpaper, but I just wanted to show you there was a time when you didn't mind being covered in food.
I know, that's horrible. It upsets me now. We're clearly reaching for a towel or a sponge or something.
And then I found this one, which shows beautifully that you always had a fondness for tidy shelving. You had sort of compact little areas, little zones of perfection arranged neatly and orderly, and that you knew where things were.
Have you ever had any compulsions? I remember you telling me about hand washing a bit.
When your sister was born, I became very protective, so I wanted to protect her from germs and bacteria. So I washed my hands so much every opportunity that the skin on the back of my hands became very rough and would bleed because of this fear of germs and what might hurt her. It's still there. I know that when I'm less happy in myself, it's worse.
So you never still have a bit, don't you? Still,
oh,
if
yeah,
we eat
quite
out
a lot.
And things,
yes,
you're quite...
yeah. And I would never embark on a journey without having, you know, antibacterial gel with me. And if I didn't have any, then I wouldn't be eating at all. Because as soon as I'm out of the house, my hands feel unclean. It's a bigger problem than I'll probably acknowledge.
I don't feel like I inherited anything in that sense.
I would be very surprised if my anxiety levels, as they were then, when you were both young, didn't have some, make some impression. Sometimes you pass on things not consciously and the person doesn't realise they're being passed on, but they're just there.
I had no idea she had that level of compulsive thought about germs and food. Suddenly it has this implied, well, you've got OCD and you've given it to me, and now I've got a disorder. And that feels so much heavier and so much more serious. And I guess that is what people say when they talk about the stigma of having a label. And to me, I'm only starting to think now, I actually really hope I haven't got it, because I hope that these things are my choice.